Thank you very much, dear Zana, dear friends, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, thank you, Deputy Minister, for your introduction and for hosting this Boris Nemtsov Forum this year in this beautiful premises of the Ministry, full of history, because it was the end of the Warsaw Pact here, so that is a very historical environment, I should say. And the fact that your name is Kafka is also very important, because it's my I think it's the most not only famous writer of Czechia, but also the most famous writer of the European continent. And if people asking to me, yeah, does it exist, European identity? European identity, does it exist? And I'm always giving Franz Kafka as the example. He said he was Jewish, he was writing in German, and he was living in Prague. So what more European you can find as a proof of the existence, I should say, of European identity. But it's also an important signal that this conference of the Boris Nemtsov Forum is organized with the support of the Czech government, and it's a sign of the support of the Czech government for the Russian civil society, and also a sign of the support for a vision of Russia which Boris Nemtsov fought for. That means Russia with respect the human rights of everyone, every citizen, a Russia whose government is accountable to the people. It was another idea of Boris Nemtsov. And the Russia which is at peace with its neighbors, what is not always the case today. And I have to tell you, Deputy Minister, I appreciate the Czech diplomacy. Why? Because it has a strong tradition on human rights. It has the experience to transform a totalitarian system into a democratic state, and to encourage also similar experiences across Eastern Europe, across Central Asia and worldwide. And beyond, you have achieved a lot, not only your economic successes in Czechia, your Skoda cars that are for the moment, you can find them everywhere across our continent, but you carry also the legacy of an important statesman, of Václav Havel, who had also a very realistic view on Russia. And I very much hope that your new minister will take up this tradition of, again, the fastest as possible. But coming back to Boris Nemtsov and his vision of Russia, I had the pleasure, Zana, and the honor, naturally, to know Boris Nemtsov for a couple of years, a few years. We cooperated together when he drummed up liberal forces against the growing authoritarian tendencies of Vladimir Putin. And it was under Boris Nemtsov's leadership that the Russian Democratic Opposition joined the family of European liberals, or Alliance for Liberals and Democrats in Europe. And I'm sad to say, but in my memory, Prague will always carry a stain, as it was here in Prague, Zana, that I learned in February 2015 about Boris' despicable murder. I was in Prague at that moment. It was at 10 or 11 o'clock in the evening when that horrible news came in. Sadly, instead of embracing Boris' vision of a European, a prosperous and a democratic Russia, the country, Russia, steered by Vladimir Putin, continues to depart from its European roots. And you know that things are sadly getting worse in Russia for the moment. Several of you, several guests present here today, tried to run for the Duma last year, and also during the local elections this year, but could not, as they there is no space for free and fair elections in Putin's Russia. And many of you present here have a personal experience with getting labeled as foreign agents because of your work, or put under pressure by law enforcement and tax authorities because of your public engagement, or even thrown into jail for expressing criticism or participating in demonstrations, peaceful demonstrations in Russia. And I have to tell you that journalists and opposition activists risk the safety of their families, their personal health, and even their life as they fight for democratic accountability of the regime of Putin, a regime that we all know now that enriches a narrow circle of Putin's friends and in fact impoverish the broad society with bad public services and at the same time one of the lowest life expectancies across Europe. I think it's more at the 110th place for the moment in the world ranking. And the picture is no better when we look at peace and stability in the neighborhood of Europe, in and around Europe. We have seen a decade, nearly a decade, or more than a decade, of violations of borders, of military invasions, of attacks against national sovereignty and respected international organizations. And I want a little bit with you, give you the list. It's a long list. It becomes a long list. Georgia in 2008, it started there. Then Ukraine in 2014, a continuous war in the east of that country with today more than 10,000 people killed in that conflict. The shooting down of MH17, still denied by the Kremlin. In 2016 also the massive disinformation efforts, for example, in the Brexit referendum, but also the interference, we all know it now, it's proved, into the US presidential elections. Cyber attacks against several Western institutions, including the German Bundestag and also, here in this house, the Czech Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Then there is the Skripal poisoning, what was nothing else than an attack with chemical weapons on EU territory. And then recently, the uncovered GRU operations against international agencies like the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons that is in the Netherlands. So the list is long. And the question that I want to raise with you at the beginning of this conference is what is and what should be the answer of the European Union to such a behavior the last decade of Vladimir Putin? Well, in 2014, dear colleagues, the EU member states responded to the war in Ukraine with what I call an unprecedented unity. It's not always the case in Europe, but there was unity. They imposed economic sanctions as a clear signal that the EU28 will and not look away if Russia uses military force against a neighboring country. And these sanctions continue to be important because, in my opinion, they stopped the Russian military offensive at a time and continue to have a deterrent effect also, hopefully, in the future. And since then, member states have coordinated their verbal reactions and have expelled also Russian agents from their territories. Here, however, and that's my point today, the joint EU strategy ends. While formal relations between the European Union and Russia are frozen and summits are not taking place, many of the member states of the European Union continue to engage in bilateral relations with Moscow, and this with a different degree of intensity, as if nothing has happened for some countries. And it is clear that what we lack, in fact, is a global strategy towards Russia, Because sanctions, okay, but sanctions alone are not enough. So in such a global strategy, we first need, in my opinion, to recognize the extent of the challenge that is in front of us. And let's not be naive, the targeted use of all possible hybrid means, the implementation of the so-called Gerasimov doctrine, the disinformation and cyber attacks against our democracies, all of this has one clear goal. We have to know that. We have to recognize that. And it is to weaken the international multilateral system, especially to undermine, in my opinion, the unity of the West. And moreover, the sole objective is also to disrupt the European Union, to weaken our collective European unity and power. As in fact, the Kremlin is afraid, and that is, in my opinion, the real reason for their behavior, as the Kremlin is afraid that Russian citizens could see the Union as an example in their fight for another Russia, a Russia with an accountable government, what is not, a Russia that abides by the international law, what is not, and a Russia that puts an end to the system of Putin, the system of capitalism for France. So the first victim of the Kremlin was Georgia. Why? Well, it wanted to join the NATO. And the second victim was Ukraine. Why? Because it opted for an association agreement with the European Union and started, in fact, to demonstrate that democracy and good governance in a Russian-speaking country are possible. And the third target were the traditional enemies, as we know them, the UK and the US. And finally, the global attack came against all our European societies, disinformation campaigns, support also for dubious pro-Kremlin figures and right-wing political parties are in full swing today, and that happens here in the Czech Republic, that happens in France, that happens in Germany, that happens in fact across the whole European continent today. And so my message today is that we must not let this happen. There is a need for what I call a counter-strategy. A counter-strategy that goes beyond the fact to say, okay, we want a number of sanctions, we want to sharpen the sanctions. That will not change a lot and not change everything. So what we need is, in fact, a counter-strategy, in my opinion, built on three layers, on three pillars. The first is to strengthen the European Union and to protect our own institutions in the European Union. We need to make sure that, for example, to give you one example, that Russia cannot steal the European elections in 2019, as it stole the US presidential elections in 2016. And therefore, we must make social media accountable, accountable for what they share, and also to prevent bots from misusing them. And more in general, we need to strengthen our capacities in the European Union in short-term debunking of disinformation and our long-time resilience. And I know that the Czech diplomacy is among the leading member states supporting the East Stratcom task force in Brussels, and I want to applaud your efforts, but we must also strengthen our cyber defense capabilities in Europe. We must also, I think, urgently complete our energy union in the European Union, because that's one of the weak spots for the moment. And step up also our fight against money laundering. And finally also build, I think, an integrated European defense community as the European pillar of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. That's the first thing. That is to defend ourselves against these attacks that are continually happening every day, every week, every month, and now for years already. The second thing what we need is to develop, I think, a new strategy. I call it a proactive strategy of engagement with the Kremlin. And that is not in contradiction with the first point. I think the stupidest thing to do is to have your sanctions, strengthen your sanctions, at the same time to have your strategy, but not to develop also a proactive strategy of engagement with the Kremlin. And that means, in my opinion, two separate things. The first is to use all available tools to increase the costs for those who violate agreed principles and also arrangements. And more concretely, I think it's necessary to impose more sanctions, especially personally targeted sanctions against those people in the Russian government, those people in the Russian business community who violate on a constant basis or profit from violations of international law or would pursue attacks against our institutions. And you know, already in 2014, the European Parliament recommended to the Council, to the European Council, to introduce the so-called Magnitsky sanctions. In other words, Magnitsky sanctions, that means, as you all know, personally targeted visa bans and asset freezes against high-ranking individuals who are involved. And this without broader economic repercussions for the ordinary Russian people, Russian citizens. You have to know that a few member states have followed these recommendations, but sadly, what didn't happen was that the whole European Council acted in that way. And unfortunately, people that violate Russian also and international law continue to bring their family and their money into the Union, giving them the safety that our rule of law guarantees. So we in fact help exactly these people who don't need any help. In parallel to those more restrictive measures, we should outline, I think, also a broader and deeper type of political and economic cooperation with Russia. This would be at the condition that the Kremlin stops its dirty games and starts to abide by the international law, including its human rights obligations, and also works to defreeze what I call the frozen conflicts in Europe. And this political and economic cooperation could include, in my opinion, a plan to negotiate also a free trade agreement between Europe and Russia, open up investment opportunities, financial assistance, and also deeper ties across several sectors, including the digital world, research, and transport. Let me call it a strategy of conditional re-engagement. If you stop this, we are offering you debt. As it was the case, and I remember that, with the Helsinki process, but also a strategy of asking for a number of democratic reforms, human rights in the former Soviet Union, and the counterpart was opening the game in cooperation. I think we need the same today. I call it conditional re-engagement, a process that could start, in my opinion, after a number of confident building measures, for example, the full implementation of the Minsk agreements, because that would be a confident building measure to open such a new strategy, and the start also of a serious dialogue between the US and Russia about nuclear arms control, what is for the moment stopped. And then thirdly, and last but not least, such a new strategy need also progress with the Kremlin. We must, besides the progress with the Kremlin, an urgently upgrading of our engagement with the Russian civil society. We do not enough for the Russian civil society. We must, in my opinion, unilaterally facilitate visas for Russian citizens. Why not? For ordinary Russian citizens. We give mainly more visas for high-ranking individuals of the regime, but not for ordinary Russian citizens. And we must open our universities and research centers also for them, increase the number of scholarships, and must also directly support the civil society across Russia, including the plurality of the Russian-speaking media, what is a constant problem today. So the Boris Nemtsov Forum has been making a critical contribution, I think, to this dialogue between European and Russian citizens, fostering relationship, trying also to develop answers to current challenges, and it is a great idea to move the forum to different European cities, Zana, every year, and I hope you will be able to extend also your work to Russian cities one day again. And that would be a great relationship with all these European cities. Even when I think that Russian cities are also European cities, but that's another discussion that I will not open this afternoon. So in order to make this happen, ladies and gentlemen, we need the European Union, first of all, to remain united, to pursue a proactive strategy, as I outlined, and not only a negative one, gain the support also of the Russian people, win the communication battle, in spite of massive disinformation, as happening today. We need also to be firm, impose clear costs for irresponsible behavior, but engage at the same time the Russian government conditionally. This is the way, in my opinion, to turn the currently negative, dangerous tendencies into a positive dynamic in the relationship between the European and Russia, and to put peace and security in Europe back on the agenda. And I think we have not a lot of time. We have to do it now, and we have the responsibility to do it now. And I wish you on this new to develop, to imagine such a new strategy, a lot of fruitful discussions today, and thank you in any way for your attention and your presence on this important Boris Nemtsov Forum conference. Thank you.